I'm here in Tokyo with my friend and someone I respect very much, Tyler, who is the CEO and the founder of the Molecular Hydrogen Institute in Utah. And what's so interesting is I first met Tyler when I was there with Dr. Joe Mercola, and Dr. Mercola was obsessed with the work that you're doing and couldn't wait to introduce you to so many of his friends and different people. And I like to really focus on what Dr. Mercola does because he leads the trend. I mean, he is so passionate and so committed to wherever sort of the new research is really showing us to be focused. And you developed your Molecular Hydrogen Institute many years ago. Can you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, well, first I got involved in hydrogen back in 2009. I was just reading and studying, and I came across an article published in 2007 in Nature Medicine by Dr. Ohta, who you just interviewed. And I was like, wow, this is really interesting. So I looked at all the research, all the studies. There wasn't a lot at that time, maybe 20, 30 articles, but it was very interesting. And then in 2013, I had the opportunity to go to Nagoya, here in Japan, and do an internship and research some of the molecular mechanisms of hydrogen and see with my own eyes that hydrogen gas really is exerting changes on a cellular level. And it was that time that I had the opportunity to meet Professor Ohta. I went to his lab, and it was so great. We got there, and he got some wine glasses, and not wine, I don't drink, but he poured hydrogen water, and we sat around talking about this hydrogen molecule as we drank hydrogen water together and enjoyed such a wonderful conversation. And when I returned back home in 2013, I thought, I saw some amazing things. I believe in this research. This needs to be out to the public. This hydrogen is really something that has the potential to help so many people. And I wanted to educate people. And at the time, nobody knew anything about hydrogen gas being beneficial or therapeutic, only that it was explosive. So I started a website. At the time, it was just a website called Molecular Hydrogen Institute. And I started educating people about the benefits of hydrogen. I put the studies on there. I wrote some articles. Then as things started going forward, I started getting invited to go to speak at conferences, first in Beijing at a biomedical hydrogen symposium there, and things just kind of started escalating. And so now I formed the organization as a science-based nonprofit, and we're just focused on advancing the education, the research, and awareness. So I'm able to speak at various medical conferences throughout the U.S., go throughout Asia and Europe and speak at various conferences and collaborate with some of the best and top minds in the field of molecular hydrogen research. And I'm just very grateful to be part of this. It's so exciting.
Well, I'm so grateful, and we all are, for the work that you're doing, the pursuit that you personally have. I mean, for the past 9 years, right? From 2009, we're at the end of 2018.
Yeah, nearly 10 years now, right?
Nearly 10 years, you've dedicated your life to it. What are the most interesting key benefits you've seen really in the past 6 months around hydrogen that you think will transform the way that people, our health in general? Like, what are the top keys?
Good question. I'd want to say that some of these new publications coming out on hydrogen being good for things like dementia, cognitive impairments, it's very powerful. I mean, there's really no drugs that have been shown to be effective for things like Alzheimer's disease. And so when we are seeing these clinical studies, not just animal studies, which were very impressive themselves, but actual human clinical studies showing that hydrogen gas can not only slow down or prevent the decline in cognitive impairments, but actually lead to improvements, to me that's amazing. And similar with stroke, cerebral infarction, what's going on with the post-cardiac arrest syndrome. The Japanese government in 2016, back in November, approved the inhalation of hydrogen gas as an advanced medicine so they could do a major clinical trial with over 360 patients in 15, 20 different hospitals so they could determine the effects and benefits of hydrogen gas for this post-cardiac arrest syndrome. So I think this is really setting major changes in the medical community. But then just for people like you and me that are healthy, that want to live a better life, the research is coming out on just exercise performance, whether it be improved recovery and endurance and exercise capacity. These are small things but are significant, especially for those who are really trying to get the cutting edge, right? Get some more energy, get yet another, you know, another bout of exercise in to push themselves harder and to recover faster. And then also the fact that hydrogen, just drinking hydrogen water, everyone drinks water, right? So you can just drink hydrogen water. And in one of the studies with healthy patients, healthy people, right? Healthy subjects, they drank the water and they had improvements in mood and anxiety and decreased stress, which to me is so great. We published a study in Scientific Reports showing that hydrogen could increase the resilience to acute and chronic stress in mice. And we expose them to, you know, forced swimming and changing their, you know, making so they can't sleep at all, and, you know, changing their food, like a whole bunch of things to cause all this stress. And those that drank hydrogen water, well, they fared a lot better, had a lot more resilience to the stress. And now again, we're seeing this transfer into these clinical studies with normal, healthy people who are just exposed to the stress of daily life, and they're able to drink hydrogen water. They have lower sympathetic nerve activation, so they're more, you know, because sympathetic is like fight or flight, right? Just the whole time. And doing that all the time is really harmful on your body. So being more parasympathetic, more relaxed, more calm, that's so good for you. And just drinking hydrogen water can do that. So these are the things that really excite me that can really benefit people, not just those patients that are sick and need help in preventing, but just healthy people already, to let have them live a higher quality of life. It's interesting, Professor Sun from China, he's kind of the pioneer in China. He kind of has this quote, I'm not sure how it translates into English, but essentially, we need oxygen to breathe. We need oxygen to live, but we need hydrogen to live well. Mm. And I think that really sums up the benefits of hydrogen in many ways.
What are some of the foods? I mean, this is so exciting and so fascinating. What are some of the foods that we can eat that will produce more hydrogen in our bodies?
Well, listen to your mother. So your mother say, eat your fruits and your vegetables, because these contain fibers, these non-digestible carbohydrates. And when they're metabolized by our intestinal bacteria, that bacteria produces hydrogen gas. And so research has shown that hydrogen gas indeed is therapeutic. It has beneficial effects, so it's really good to eat those fibers. But it's also very curious, and it's one of the enigmas in hydrogen research, because when you compare eating fibers and producing a lot of hydrogen gas that way compared to just drinking hydrogen water, which is actually a smaller amount of hydrogen gas, when you compare the two, often simply drinking hydrogen water is more effective than getting it from the fibers. And I just was discussing this with Professor Ohta, and one of the reasons for this could be because hydrogen gas seems to modulate signal transduction and gene expression. Mm-hmm. And so in order to do this, we have to have this intermittent pulse exposure. So when you drink hydrogen water, you have a high increase in the blood, and then it goes down quickly. Whereas from bacteria, it kind of slowly goes up and stays there for a while and slowly goes back down. So it doesn't have the same effect on our genes and on our cells as it does drinking hydrogen water.
So what about the safety of it, right? It seems so new, even though the research, as you mentioned, Dr. Ohta has been researching it for over 13 years. The research is there, it's really culminating. What about on the safety, and can children take it?
Yeah, excellent question. So far, there's no reported adverse effects from taking hydrogen, even at high concentrations. And scientifically, that's somewhat makes us skeptical, because if something has a beneficial effect, then it should have a noxious effect, especially at high doses, at high concentrations. Mm-hmm. We don't really see that with hydrogen, even at cell culture at very high concentrations, or in animals or humans, we don't see that. And the safety is really well established, even before Professor Ohta started his research 13 years ago, because they've actually used hydrogen gas to prevent decompression sickness in deep sea diving since the 1940s at literally hundreds, millions of times higher concentrations than what we use for therapeutic uses. And as we mentioned, it's produced by our bacteria, so we're always exposed to hydrogen gas. It's very natural. It's not some, you know, alien foreign substance or something. It's very natural to our body. But simply drinking it has these beneficial effects, and so far we haven't seen any adverse effects. So as far as children, pregnant women, there's no reason to suggest for them not to have it, and the animal studies suggest that they should have it for sure.
I love to hear this. This is so exciting. It's so cutting edge, so transformative. You and I are going to go out and explore Tokyo a little bit, and how hydrogen is used in the daily life, and I can't wait to be doing that with you. So Tyler, thank you very much for opening up my eyes and that of so many other people to the power of molecular hydrogen.
I appreciate it. Thanks for the opportunity.